The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. May His grace and His blessing be with us now and unto the age of all ages. Amen. I greet you, dear brothers and sisters, on this, the second Sunday of the blessed Coptic month of Abib. And in this morning's gospel reading from Matthew chapter 18, verses 1 through 9, we find our Savior answering a question that was posed by His disciples. Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Until the time the disciples asked this question, our Savior had been preparing them for the truth that He was about to be betrayed and handed over into the hands of sinful men, and falsely accused and scourged and tried and crucified, and then on the third day that He would rise again from the dead. He was teaching them about the mystery of His incarnation and why He came into the world to save mankind. But the disciples didn't get it. They didn't understand. Instead, they wanted to know who among them was going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. After all they heard from our Savior, they couldn't help but think, "What's this going to mean for me? What glory am I going to get out of this?" And in response to this attitude, our Savior gives them and to all of us a magnificent teaching on humility. He brought to Himself a little child who, according to one tradition of the Holy Church, was none other than Saint Ignatius, the Bishop of Antioch, who later became the Bishop of Antioch and a martyr of the Church. And after taking this child and putting him close to Him, He said to His disciples, "Assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." In light of these beautiful words, this beautiful teaching on humility, I hope to offer to you three humble points on humility. Let us speak about the humility of God, the humility of the children of God, and then the steps that we must take to acquire humility. First of all, dear brothers and sisters, let us meditate on the humility of God. If there was ever one who deserved to be served, it was the incarnate Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ. But we see that He came not to be served, but rather to serve and to give His life for many. This is why we adore Christ, because He didn't come to seek His own greatness, but rather to seek our greatness. We worship Him because of His selfless sacrifice, even unto death, by which He offered us salvation. There is much more, however, to the humility of God than what our Lord Jesus Christ did for us. Oftentimes, when we think about God's humility, we think only about our Lord Jesus Christ and what He did for us, but the humility of God is actually a much greater topic than just this. For example, consider the humility of God in creating the universe. We know that God is everything. God is all in all. Did God have to create the universe in order to be happy? Of course not. Did God need to create the universe? Absolutely not. And yet we find God in His love and His humility creating this universe, creating the visible things that we see, like the earth, the mountains, the seas, the trees, the animals, etc., and also the invisible things that we don't see, like the angels, like the souls in each and every human being, and the entire spiritual realm. Not only that, but we really see God's humility in the creation of man. When God fashioned Adam from the dust of the earth, and when He fashioned the woman, Eve, from the rib of Adam, He gave to them something that really belonged only to Him. We read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 25 and 26, that God created man in his own image and in his own likeness. There's something very beautiful in this, dear brothers and sisters, because when you read the account of the creation, you will see that as God creates the sky, the earth, the water, the plants, the animals, God creates them all with a command. He says, "Let there be," and then there is. He commands them to be created. But then we read in Genesis that when he creates man, he doesn't command man to be created, but God actually deliberates. We read in Genesis 1, 25 and 6, he says, "Let us create man in our image and according to our likeness." What was going on here? It was God the Father speaking to God the Son and saying to God the Son, "Let us create man in our image and according to our likeness." And that creation happened in the context of the Holy Spirit, because the Spirit was hovering over the waters. So the creation of man was a Trinitarian action. It involved the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and man was created to be in the image of God, unlike all of the rest of the animals. This is a side point, but I oftentimes am amused when people speak about evolution, and they talk about man coming up from the animals. They're actually getting it in reverse. God made man in his image, so mankind was always exalted. But when we disobeyed God and we separated ourselves from God, we made ourselves to be more like the animals. We fell. That's why we speak about a fall, because we were here. We were God's exalted creation, and then we fell and we became more like the animals. But those who preach evolution are actually preaching something backwards. They're saying we came up from the animals, but that's not true. We were made in God's image and in his likeness. And he gave to every human being something that belongs only to him. That's what it means that we were created in the image of God. So what is the image of God in mankind? Well, one of the things that relates to the image of God in us is free will. No other animal has free will. What this essentially means is that God, when he created us, essentially created a creature that is fully capable of denying him. God created man and made him fully capable of rejecting him. Every human being has the power, the authority, the sovereignty, and the free will to reject God, because every human being has free will as part of the image of God within him. Now, in the context of God's humility, think about this for a moment. Imagine, dear brothers and sisters, that the God of gods, the Lord of lords, he condescends and he humbles himself so much that it creates a creature that can basically say no to him. And not only that, but he places this creature, the one that can deny him, he places him as the head of all of creation. Man has dominion over all of the creation. The one creature that can reject God is made the master of the universe. This is the great humility of God. Dear brothers and sisters, Metropolitan Callisto Suer, a famous Greek Orthodox hierarch and scholar, he sums it up in this way. He says, "It is as natural for God to be humble as it is for him to be almighty." This is a great paradox that really escapes our understanding, because on the one hand, we know that God is omnipotent, all-powerful. He is omniscient, all-knowing. He is omnipresent, he fills all things. He is eternal and whole and complete and perfect and holy. He needs nothing. That we know this on the one hand. But on the other hand, he is humble. He is humble, not just in the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ towards us, but God himself, the Holy Trinity, is humble. He is humble. This is the great humility of God, dear brothers and sisters. And when we consider this, it helps us to understand the humility of our Lord Jesus Christ, the second person of the Holy Trinity. What did our Lord Jesus Christ do for us? Our Lord condescended, he bowed the heavens low, he took flesh from the Holy Theotokos Mary, he united his divinity with our weak and sinful humanity in a perfect unity. And then he came to the world and he taught us and he healed us from our spiritual and physical diseases. He humbled himself and suffered and died for us before being raised from the dead after 3 days. And then the really amazing thing, the really scandalous thing, and this is really the great thing about the ascension, is that when our Lord ascends into heaven, does he leave the human body back on earth? Does he abandon that human body that he took to himself, that he united with his divinity? He doesn't. When he ascends into heaven, he takes our humanity with him to heaven, so that now at the right hand of God in heaven, there is a human being. There is our Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect God and perfect man. Think about what God did for us. He took our nature, united it with his divinity. He taught us, blessed us, did everything for us. And then he took our nature into heaven. Saint Cyril of Alexandria, he has this beautiful quote in which he says, "Imagine what God the Father said when God the Son returned to heaven at the time of his ascension. He might have said to his Son, 'Welcome back, Son.' And his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, said to his Father, 'Thank you, Father. There are many more like me coming after me.' Because of what he did, he opened the gates for us to enter into the kingdom of heaven. This is the great humility of God. God loved us so much that he humbled himself for us so much. And this is the icon, the perfect icon of humility that we must keep before our eyes at all times." And that leads us to our second point, which is to speak about the humility of the children of God, our own humility. As we have seen, God's humility is so incredible. It is so amazing. It is so wonderful that it defies human understanding and words. And in today's gospel, God wishes to teach us to follow in his humble footsteps. Christ did not seek anyone to serve him, but he came to serve others. Therefore, he is the icon or the prototype or the perfect image of humility. St. Paul teaches us to be conformed to the image of the Son of God. And that means that if Christ is the perfect image of humility, then we are called to change our lives so that we can reflect that perfect image of humility in our lives as well. This is our destiny. This is what God has chosen for us. He wants us to be like him. He wants us to serve. He wants us to be the children of God who never seek to be first in anything. And this is what our Savior essentially said to his disciples in today's gospel. If you don't abandon your false opinions about the kingdom and your conceited hopes to obtain the first place in the kingdom of heaven, then you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. This is why he presented a trial to them, because we know that children have pure hearts. Children don't think about fame or possessions. They are meek and they are humble because they don't know anything about envy and vanity. They don't have the desire to be first unless we ourselves put it in our children. And how sad it is when we tell our children, "You go and be first before anyone else." Sometimes that leads them to develop the wrong type of personality in their lives. Only the person who humbles himself like a child will enter the kingdom of heaven. And that means making ourselves to be less than others. It means setting aside our imagined self-importance. It means turning away from sinful ambition and pride toward humility and weakness, and becoming like a pure child who doesn't care about these things. When we do this, we will become great in the kingdom of heaven. Finally, dear brothers and sisters, now that we see how God is humble in a perfect way and how much he wants us to imitate him, let us speak finally about the steps we need to take in order to do this, in order to be humble. There are many ways of becoming humble, and indeed the books of the church are full of beautiful teachings and stories. But I want to focus with you on something a little bit different. I want to focus with you on how our Mother, the Holy Church, teaches us to be humble. The first way we learn humility in the Holy Church is by practicing obedience. We don't practice obedience enough in this world. The world teaches us to be first in everything. Someone cuts us off on the freeway, our pride is wounded, so we accelerate and we want to make sure we get in front of them to show them that we were first and we have to remain first. A wife in the context of a marriage, she hears from television and things like this that she should be the equal or even higher than her husband. And so she gives her husband a hard time. Sometimes, of course, the husband might deserve it, but other times the husband might simply trying to be leading the family to righteousness. But she doesn't like this, and so she doesn't practice that obedience that God commands her. Even in the church, sometimes you'll have a servant who is underneath an older servant, but the younger servant will think, I know better. If I'm just given a chance, I could benefit the people more. They will love me more. I just want to get this person out of the way. And so we try to get the person out of the way. But this, dear brothers and sisters, is not the practice of obedience. My dear brothers and sisters, the way to humility, the way to practicing obedience, is simply to accept whatever comes your way. Whether you agree with it or not, whether you think you know better or not, whether you think this is the wrong direction or not, to simply accept what happens and to trust in God that God will defend you. Don't think that if you are obedient that you're going to be trampled on. The day will come when God will justify you. The day will come when God will defend you himself. And for you, that should be enough. You shouldn't want the glory of the world or the praise of men. For you, it should just be enough to practice obedience and to let God defend you. We oftentimes think that when we insist on our way, that we are free. But when you think about it, you're not free. Because in the end, either you're going to be a slave to others by practicing obedience, or you're going to be a slave to yourself. Either way, you're going to be a slave. But when you insist on your way, you are actually becoming a slave to yourself. You're becoming a slave to your own desires. You're becoming a slave to what you think is right and your sense of pride. So you're still a slave, but the difference is you're a slave to yourself. How much greater would you be, dear brothers and sisters, if you were like Christ and you made yourself to be a slave to others? You made yourself to be a servant to others, and you served people rather than your own desires. This is the first way we can be humble, by practicing perfect obedience. The second way we learn humility in the Holy Church is by constantly praying the words, Lord, have mercy. If you were to summarize the Divine Liturgy, what we do today, and every other service in the church, if you were to summarize them into simply one sentence, that would be the sentence, Lord, have mercy. We don't repeat the sentence over and over again in our liturgy because we have nothing else to say or because we doubt God's love for us, but we pray it to repeatedly remind ourselves that we are sinners and that we are in need of God's healing and purification. Don't ever treat those words in the liturgy like a formality. Lord, have mercy, let's move on with it. No, every time you hear that sentence, Lord, have mercy, think about your sins. Think about your weakness. Think about everything that is wrong in your life, and then ask God quietly from your heart to have mercy on you. That is why the Holy Church gives us those words over and over again in our service. The second way we learn humility in the Holy Church is by praying the Jesus Prayer. For those of you who don't know what this prayer is, you can quickly memorize it now. It's very simply this: My Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. The idea behind this prayer is to keep our minds focused on the presence of God and our constant need for forgiveness. Why do we sin? We sin because we forget God. We forget His presence with us. But this prayer, if we pray it when we wake up, if we pray it while we shower, while we drive, while we're going to school, while we're studying, if we pray it in between classes, during lunchtime, etc., then we will be reminded of the presence of God. And remember what happened to St. Peter when he realized that he was in the presence of God. What did he do? He fell down on his face and he said, Lord, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. So every time we remember the presence of God, we see ourselves for who we are, and we ask God to have mercy on us. So the more we pray this throughout the day, the more we will become humble, because we'll be aware of God around us in our presence, and we will ask Him for forgiveness and mercy. The third way that we learn humility in the Holy Church, and specifically in the Divine Liturgy, is by what you're about to do in just 5 minutes, which is you're going to exchange the kiss of peace right after the prayer of reconciliation. People oftentimes don't understand what we're doing when we do this. We're not just going to our neighbor and greeting them. We're not looking to see who is here and who didn't come, or what people are wearing or anything like that. But instead, when we exchange the kiss of peace, we are living what our Lord Jesus Christ commanded us. He told us in the gospel, therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. The idea, therefore, is that at the beginning of the liturgy that we're going to start now, we have to work out our differences with our brothers and sisters before we can approach Holy Communion. And it's obvious how this helps us to be more humble, because oftentimes we ask forgiveness of others just for the sake of peace when we don't feel we've really done anything wrong. But this way, when we actually come in the liturgy and we say, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, forgive me, when we kiss them, what we are saying is, I am humbling myself before you. If I have offended you, forgive me. And I really mean that, because I want to be able to pray the rest of the liturgy and to receive communion at the end. And don't think that this kiss of peace is something that we only do in the church. Every family should do this in a way every night before bed. Do not let any husband or wife or children go to sleep angry with one another. Be reconciled to one another before the day ends. And if need be, offer the Matanya and ask for forgiveness, because you know, dear brothers and sisters, many people go to sleep and they don't wake up. And the last thing you want is to go to sleep with anger in your heart and to meet Christ with that anger in your heart. I know several elderly people who have learned something beautiful. When they pray at night, they simply say to God, in addition to all of their other prayers, Lord, I don't have anything against anyone. And if anyone has something against me, I pray that you may send them to me so that I can offer them a Tanya and ask for their forgiveness. This is what we need to do, dear brothers and sisters. The fourth way we learn humility through the Holy Church, of course, is through the mystery of confession and, of course, repentance. A person bears his heart before God and his Father of confession, and that humbles him. That's one of the reasons why confession is done in front of a priest. Is it embarrassing? Yes. Is it supposed to be embarrassing? Yes. Because this is how we humble ourselves. This is how we learn to be humble and to really come and bear our souls before God. Does that mean, of course, that just because confession is done in front of the priest, there is a risk that he will speak about your sins to someone else or his family or other priests? Of course not. Don't worry about that. But instead, focus on bearing your soul before him and humbling yourself before God and before the priest, who is there simply to advise you, to guide you, and to pray that God may forgive your sins. And God will forgive your sins if you do this in the right way. This is why when we come for confession, we make sure we confess everything. There's nothing that you can say that the priest hasn't already heard, or maybe the priest hasn't already done himself. So don't worry about that. Confess everything in humility, and God will be gracious. As the thrice-blessed Pope Shenouda said, if we forget our sins, God will remember them. But if we remember our sins, then God will forget them. And as one of the fathers of the Philokalia said, when the mind sees its own worthlessness and how far it falls short of the perfection of others, a man naturally starts counting himself as dust and ashes, and not as a man but as a dog, as though in all respects he becomes behind all rational beings on earth, and he is more poor and empty. We want this feeling, dear brothers and sisters, because this is what leads us to the kingdom of heaven. And so to conclude our word this morning, today God invites us to practice humility in our lives. He invites us to gaze upon his own indescribable humility, and he asks us to imitate his example so that we can be conformed to him who is the true image of perfect humility. And he invites us to learn humility through several means, and I mentioned to you only very few, just a few of the ways we learn humility through the Holy Church and the Divine Liturgy. May God grant us to serve him in humility, purity, and in righteousness all the days of our lives. To him be all glory, to the all-holy Father, to the all-holy Son, and to the all-holy Spirit, now and forever, and unto the age of all ages. Amen.